Hello, I'm going to be explaining a few of the key concepts, drivers, and use cases for the AR cloud. This is in preparation or to provide context for the other speakers in our panel. So what exactly constitutes an AR cloud product or service? It's something that's using or creating the data about the real world. And this can include many different types of data. It can also include the metadata about the data. And it can be things that are stored, or it can be also using live sensor readings, for example, connected machinery or buildings and other things like that. And what the AR cloud does is it provides this glue, a way of combining all of the resources that are on an AR device, as well as those that are in a network, and can enhance those, process those data in a variety of different ways for the purpose of localization or registering with the real world, and also to store those materials and data and objects off the device where there is more more content, more capacity at a lower cost. And it does all these things in real time. So that's the summary of the big picture. And now I'm going to dive into a few more of the details. In fact, AR cloud is a concept that is nested in within some other concepts that are very familiar to us and have been around for decades. The longest is ubiquitous computing, but we've also heard a lot about spatial computing, and there are many, many different types of spatial computing, of which AR cloud is one. Just to make sure that I set the context correctly, ubiquitous computing is something that is everywhere. It's pervasive and universal, and it's this seamless integration of information as a service that can help us in our lives and perform our jobs. And it includes this concept of ambience and being everywhere pervasive. It's interactive and uses many advanced technologies in artificial intelligence. Spatial computing is a special type of ubiquitous computing that pertains to 3D volumes. So it's not just things that are geospatial data, although geospatial data are an important type of spatial computing, but it's this idea of spatial being three-dimensional. And when we have spatial computing, there's a change, a shift that the user experiences between it's the user itself and the computing resources that they have. Specifically, the user goes from, you know, accessing information anywhere, anytime, to users being immersed and engaged and interacting with this 3D or time-based data about the physical world right around them. And what this might look like symbolically is that there are attributes of the physical world at the bottom, the atoms, and the users are engaged in interacting with the data, the bits about that space. So this summarizes spatial computing. Spatial data, that 3D data, is the raw material for AR cloud. It's being continuously generated and utilize. So it's a stream of data is one way of thinking about it. And because it's continuously being generated and it has all these features we've spoken about, it's the core, the lava. I like to think of it as the molten center of the AR cloud. So it's 3D data that pertains to the physical world and users can interact with it. And they interact with it using an AR presentation system, of course, and we're quite familiar with those presentation systems. And we know that they encompass and have in them some artificial intelligence to help the user use the world intelligently. There are things like sensors and speakers and, of course, a central processing unit, graphic processing units. There's user interface elements, personalization, the AR execution engine, and other things like renderers. And those help us to see things in the physical world in context. So no surprises here. Now, let's go a little bit further. What sits between the AR presentation system and this core? Well, I call them this is the layer that we're going to be speaking about. And this is really the new material in AR cloud. It's really that we can use these resources at this dark gray layer for continuous contextual search to connect the data in the AR cloud with the physical world where the user can experience and interact with it in their physical world. So this is really key. The darkest ring that's closest to the data is where we're focusing, and discovery is a fundamental service that is enriched there. Now, in parallel with discovery about the environment and what information is there, there are these processing zones. And processing zones are very important. This is the fourth major part of the framework. And what they are is the workhorses that are required to crunch the data for the users. And they're doing this continuously in real time using artificial intelligence and machine learning based on data sets that we have, of course. And this is very consistent with what we've seen elsewhere. This is a way of distributing the processing that's required for real time detection of the world in a low latency way, and to offload the requirements so that the device has a higher longer battery life and a higher performance for the user. And these resources that are on the device and those that are on the network are connected through 5G networks. So this has a really important role. This concept here is fundamental. Now, within the cloud or off the device, we can also see that it's not just a black box with no intelligence. On the contrary, there are services that are at the edge and resources that are very close to the user. There's a local network where you can see data analysis and control responses. But these are this model that I'm showing you here is quite well developed for IoT data processing. And we can just extrapolate and adopt some of these principles when designing AR cloud infrastructure. So we just to recap, now at the edge, the very closest to the user, there should be the reality layers where the very dynamic data is being stored and used. And then in the cloud or farther from the user is the more static parts of reality, the terrain, the buildings, roads, trees, things like that don't move, and that can be shared globally. So those are all important components. Now we've talked about the processing zones, how they're created, and the crucial function that they serve for AR cloud. Now let's talk a little bit about these. What do they do? What are they doing in real time? The first one is reality capture, also called spatial mapping. And this is one of the most mature blocks of technology in this processing zone. There are other technologies being developed for this as well. The second major block in the processing zone is spatial mapping and geopose. So this is the ability to anchor the reality when we encounter it and to add intelligence to it so that we can segment it and find the necessary components. And then finally, the processing zone can contextually tag and provide semantic understanding in order to make sure that the information is easily queried by the discovery service. So this is with this turquoise color, I express how all of this is joined into one system and and this is a framework that I propose we use when describing the AR cloud system. So to summarize, what is AR cloud? It's a system that encompasses the creation, management, and use of persistent, dynamic, and shareable machine-readable representation of the physical world. And it's used, it has many forms already. We can see that we've been capturing, people have been modeling the physical world for a very long time. It's also pertaining to connected objects. The user's position is fundamental to this. And by mapping, analyzing, and continuously querying the spatial data, we can provide immersive augmented reality experiences that are very rich. There's another aspect of this, which I think is very important, which is world understanding. World understanding leverages all that I've just spoken about. It is the ability to use that semantic knowledge and the 3D geometry to associate features and behaviors of objects and activities. Take, for example, this tree, which is being detected in 3D and generating a point cloud, perhaps, or some other model, which is then analyzed using artificial intelligence to understand that this is a tree. It has the shape, it has the behaviors of that class of tree. And then you might also recognize that there is a bird in the air above or near the tree. So you can then assume that the bird is flying to the tree and will soon land there. So this is how we express world understanding. World understanding is very, very important benefit of AR cloud. I'm going to quickly summarize some of the drivers for AR cloud adoption and spatial computing. The first is technology is just continuously improving, and that AR is going to be anywhere, anytime, at a continuous scale. We have to be able to take advantage of it wherever we are all the time. Collaboration is also one of the fundamental technological drivers as people are more and more working remotely and they need to share the same technologies, but not on their devices. They need to be able to load and distribute that device on the edge and in the cloud. There are also a variety of societal drivers. People want to have a richer lifestyle. They want to do contextual learning and be guided through their lives, whether they be historical, cultural heritage, museums, and so forth. They also want to collaborate and share in their personal and professional lives in a seamless way. Now, there's also a set of business drivers and industrial and business use cases. People are always trying to optimize their performance. That's to improve the quality, save time, save resources, as well as to reduce risk and increase all kinds of productivity. Finally, AR and the use of AR cloud is going to improve how humans can interact with more and more sophisticated machines over time. And we're also having more and more 3D visualization in our environment. So we are in more and more expecting the world to be in three dimension, represented in three dimensions. And we also expect, so how is all this going to be used? We know about the drivers, but in fact, what we're really going to do is use these layers of knowledge about the physical world being the reality layers below, whether it's in atoms or bits, that's the reality layers. And then we have these thematic layers above, and each layer contains AR experiences, live data streams, static experiences, service applications, and so forth, to make our lives more productive across many, many domains. So in summary, there are really infinite number of use cases. It's really important to be able to categorize and understand those as having different requirements, because enterprise users and consumers have such fundamentally different expectations. And this table just summarizes a few of things that we know about four use case categories: the guidance, to navigate us and help us in our daily lives to perform things, to learn, so to enrich our brains, and to be aware of the new and important things around us, whether they are connected machines or whether they're emergency vehicles or autonomous vehicles. And finally, to enrich our collaborations with our colleagues, with our family and our social network. So that's all I have for this this presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.